Father Ostreya, I'd like to go back to that strategy or approach that you mentioned before we took a break, the decoupling strategy. Of course, this would necessitate beefing up our healthcare system, in particular healthcare facilities. But are you seeing enough facilities being built or expanded to be able to make sure that even if there would be surges in the future, there won't be any congestion in the healthcare facilities?
Well, as Ms. Abinahar pointed out, it is not the facilities that is the limiting factor in the Philippines. It is manpower. And in the April surge, for example, the NCR reported 9,500 or so beds, but occupancy never exceeded around 7,500 beds. And so you have this 2,000 empty bed gap. And I think everyone has come to understand that that gap is because we simply lack the nurses to staff those beds. And you're seeing that again, you know, it deeply breaks my heart that I'm here. Nurse has to serve 15 COVID patients when the standard of care is 1 to 4 for intensive care, high maintenance patients like a COVID patient. And so what you're seeing now is we spend a lot of time talking about beds. What we really need to talk about is how many nurses are there, and was the government able to increase the hiring of nurses from April to August to augment the number of nurses that we had in the NCR, which was already falling short of the 9,500 beds that was reported on the list, right? So I was just wondering with Ma'am Abinahar, whether or not the number of nurses in the NCR has increased dramatically since the last surge. Otherwise, we will expect that around 7,500, we will reach maximum capacity simply because we don't have enough nurses to care for our kababayans.
Okay, let's answer that. Ms. Maristela Abinahar, dumami ba yung number of nurses, at least in the National Capital Region? And number two, pakisagot na rin yung concern before, di ba? The concern about the hiring strategy of the Department of Health. What would be the best approach to be able to beef up the manpower requirements during the pandemic as far as healthcare workers are concerned?
To answer Father Nick's query a while ago, until now, particular time, wala pa rin po tayong significant increase sa number of nursing personnel. In fact, ito rin po yung nire-raise ng ating mga private hospitals and government hospitals na dagdagan talaga ang nursing personnel. Yung emergency hiring that was adopted by the Department of Health is a three months contract. And according to them, no, so far, they have hired only 9,000 daw. Pero 9,000 personnel, saan kaya napunta yung 9,000? Hindi lang yun sa hospital, I'm very sure. No? So, dineployed din sila sa iba-ibang lugar. So yung in terms of yung sa mga ospital ngayon na nasa saturate na, napupuno na, kailangan talagang baglaan ng personnel according dun sa ideal, no? Like in ICU, dapat isang nurse, isang COVID patient, hindi pwedeng tatlo o apat na patient, lalo na kung critical yan and severe. Sa COVID ward naman, hindi naman tama na 12 patients or more ang hinahandle ng mga nurses. Dapat yan around 4 or 6 lang ang maximum na hinahawakan nilang COVID patient. So, kailangan aralin ng Department of Health yung pangangailangan in our actual, no, ng mga health facilities. At yun yung punuan, dagdagan, no? Kasi like for instance sa isang private hospital dito sa Manila, meron dati po ano lang sila 50 plus yung personnel nila, but according to the chief nurse 17 na lang sila ngayon. Kasama okay. Pa doon sa 17.
Okay. Tama ba yung nakikita nating problema, Ms. Abinahar? So many nurses are reluctant to actually participate in this emergency hiring program by the Department of Health. Number one, siguro nandun yung fear of exposure, but we know that is par for the course, and healthcare workers are very much willing to take on that challenge. But the more serious problem is this correct to presume this? is that the lack of sufficient benefits that should be given to them if they take on this challenge. Yun yung problema. Benefits.
Isang problema ang pasahod. Number one, napakababa ng sahod dati ng mga nurses natin dito. For nurses working in the private hospital, they are obliged to, the private hospital owners are giving them only according to minimum wage law, which is 537 a day. So yung 537 a day in a month, that's 11,814. Can you imagine hanggang saan no ang kayang sagutin ng 11,000 na yon kung sumunod doon sa minimum wage law? Pero kalakhan hindi sumusunod. So meron tayong maraming nurses na ang tinatanggap lang po ay 8 to 10,000 a month. So kung may pamilya sila, may mga dependent sila, hindi na kayang mabuhay. Basic survival, hirap na no, para sa ating mga private nurses. Remember, we have more private hospitals than government hospital. We have 1,072 DOH licensed private hospital. And we only have 66 DOH hospitals. And about 700 plus na LGU hospitals. So, ang layo ng gap ng public and private na pasahod. And even in the government, Christian, yung sinabi ng Supreme Court noong 2019 na dapat pinapatupad ang salary grade 15 na entry salary, until this time, issue malaki yan. Kasi hindi po lahat ay nagpapatupad. Dito sa ating bansa, merong dalawang klase ng nurses in the government. Regular and contractual. Yung mga contractual, they are receiving much lower than what is in the law. Now, instead of salary grade 15, they're only receiving salary grade 11, which is 20,000 plus. Whereas yung nasa, yun naman pong nasa salary grade 15 na mga nurses, depende pa po yan, na mga regular, depende pa po kung ito ay may budget according sa mga LGUs. Kasi when you go outside NCR, mababa yung halaga ng kanilang sahod. Hindi na yan 100%. Pababa okay. Na pababa.
Okay. Sige, punta ako naman si Father Nicanor Ostriaco. Again, before the Delta variant was confirmed, you were warning against the a shotgun approach to vaccination. Did you see any improvement now that there are certain threats, or actually, there are surges happening from many parts of the Philippines already? Diba strategy nyo dati, build a wall around Metro Manila. Eh ngayon, kung saan-saan na nanggagaling yung surges driven by the Delta variant.
So what is happening now is that the DOH has set up an alert level, alert 1, alert 2, alert 3, alert 4, and that there are certain LGUs that have been deemed alert 4 that have now become priority vaccine targets. And this actually makes sense, because you see what they are trying to do in this particular case. It's not really shotgun anymore. There's a very specific strategy to try to increase the vaccination rate in that hot spot, so that when they release the lockdown, there will not be a resurgence. The difficulty, of course, is there is a lag always. There's always a lag in vaccination. So, you know, we can only vaccinate to prevent the next surge, right? And that's the challenge we have. But I know that this month there is actually a we're not as worried about the supply for vaccines for the first time. Now it's a matter of administering the vaccines and increasing the jabbing rate across the country. There still is a focus on the NCR plus 8. There still will be an attempt to protect the NCR plus 8, to protect the country from other future variants. But as we discussed, Christian, the last time I was on your show, the Delta changes everything. It's a game changer. And you're seeing that here right now. We're trying to really constrain it. The Lambda, you know, people are talking about the Lambda was detected. There is data that shows that when you put the Lambda and the Delta together, the Delta beats the Lambda. So if this is the case, if the Delta beats the Lambda, and we're still waiting for confirmation of that, then the Lambda will struggle to spread in the Philippines because the Delta is already here. So if the Delta, if the Lambda had come first, that would have been a problem. But now that the Delta is here, if we work to contain the Delta, we effectively will contain the Lambda as well, because the Lambda is not as strong, according to some recent preprints, as the Delta. So the Delta really is our enemy at the moment, and hopefully we will be able to conquer this in the next couple of weeks.
Okay, I remember in our previous conversation, you said that vaccines are not a good approach to deal with current surges. So in this case, if you roll out more vaccines, increase the vaccination, the daily vaccination, in hotspots where there are existing surges, what help would it do? What good would it do to deal with that current surge?
So the only way this would help is that if you're able to reach significant population immunity while you are vaccinating like crazy. So this is why in the NCR, they are targeting 50% by the end of August, right? So the hope is that we will be in ECQ, they will continue to vaccinate, we will start to open up. And because of these significant increases in vaccinated people, as the virus begins to breathe, it encounters vaccinated people. They might not be fully vaccinated yet, but hopefully even these partially vaccinated people have somewhat of a higher protection. But you're correct. Vaccines in principle are not meant to deal with the current surge. Lockdowns are. Anything that limits mobility, masks, all of this is supposed to deal with the current surge. The vaccine is supposed to protect for the next surge.
Okay, now given the current rate of vaccination that we are seeing now and the rate of infection driven by the Delta variant, how soon or how much longer can we reasonably expect herd immunity, at least in Metro Manila?
Well, so the Delta, because the Delta is more transmissible, herd immunity, actually, the threshold goes up. So for the Alpha Beta variant, it was 70%. We would have to technically reach 83% or above with the Delta. So this is the added challenge, because now we would have to bring our children into play, because our children are 30% of the population. So in a way that the Alpha did not really worry us, we now have to vaccinate our children in order to attain the herd immunity that we would need against the Delta, 83-85%. But we will be able to get about 70% by November. I really still think that is attainable. And other countries have shown that at that level, you have uncoupling. So it will spread, you will still have cases, but they will be milder because most of those patients will have been vaccinated at some level. And at that point, the stress on our healthcare workers, the stress on our healthcare system will begin to decrease. And so we won't be so worried about surges in the way we are worried about them now. But really, you know, the next 5 days is so critical. If the cases in Manila continue to increase, if they breach 4,000 in the next day or so, it suggests that the ECQ is not as effective as the ECQ in April. And the government would have to figure out how to improve the stringency of the ECQ.
Okay. Finally, kay Ms. Maristela Binahar, very briefly because we don't have much time anymore. There was a threat or warning to have mass resignation of healthcare workers. What do you think of this? Is this threat real? And what do you think of this happening at this time during the pandemic?
I think we should not call it as a mere threat, no? It's a pressure on the part of the nurses, no? How to survive in their workplaces, given na they are not really appreciated, their salaries are very low, they are not protected, yung ganon, their benefits are not really released to them, etc. They they think of another option na makahanap ng better work. And their tendency is to think of resigning from their work. This is not meant to stress the government, no? But the impact of that is on the healthcare delivery system. Kasi kapag nawala ang ating mga nurses or lalong bumaba ang bilang ng ating mga nurses, ang magsasuffer ay ang mga tao, no? So kaya dapat makita ito ng pamahalaan, yung urgency na mas hiring, yung urgency na ibigay yung mga benefits nila. Hindi naman sila humihingi ng more than, no, doon sa pangangailangan nila. In fact, they are just asking for what is due for them according to law. And they know, we know very well na may pondo. So bakit hindi ma-release, no? Kaya hindi naman natin sinasabi na pigilan sila or i-discourage sila doon sa kanaiisip nila na mag-resign. Kasi ano yun eh, choice eh. Ano nila yun, decision nila yun para mabuhay yung kanilang family. Now the only way to address this is kung kikilos kaagad ang government at i-release yung kanilang benefits at i-ensure na itataas yung kanilang sweldo at mabibigyan sila ng protection doon sa workplace. That's okay. The only way for them to stay.
Ms. Maristela Binuhar and Father Nicanor Austriaco, thank you very much for joining us tonight.